My name is Veronica Aguilar, but my friends call me Vero. I'm 16 years old and a senior in high school. In my community, like everywhere else, people are scared for their safety. Fear is not being able to leave your house after a certain hour because gangsters will be outside. Going into a different neighborhood that you're not familiar with, wearing colors that they may not approve of, getting confused for somebody else.
We've had a lot of break-ins. We've had a lot of kids on drugs. We've had a lot of kids hanging around. Unfortunately, there was racial fights.
As a parent, I'm very nervous about the climate of the times. You know, just seems like people don't respect anyone anymore, you know?
I'm concerned about my child, my kids' well-being up in the future, other kids in the neighborhood, myself, my neighbors. I mean, it's really upsetting, and something have to really be done about this.
I would like to tell police officers that they must get more interested in this community.
Children need excitement in their lives. If they can't have excitement, they're going to create excitement.
It's just amazing at what it's coming to. My generation is a real crazy generation, and I just see that crime is increasing and increasing, and it's just getting scarier and scarier to walk through the streets at night.
Anyone working in law enforcement knows that juvenile delinquency and crime threaten our families and our community. But there is hope. Through intervention, committed people throughout the system are making a difference. Detective Sandy Sandoval of the Los Angeles Police Department says the first step is seeing the signs of trouble.
You know, and there's a denial in the community, there's a denial in the family many times. And I'll tell you the honest truth, I think there's still school administrators out there that many times say, well, you know, that's not really gang stuff, and that's really not my school, and not my students. But they need to be aware that it could be their students. And we have a saying, you know, that if a kid is like a wannabe, it's going to be a gonna-be. And they need to be aware of that. Before it gets to this drastic, as you see the background behind us, they need to be aware that slight graffiti, that slight tagging that's starting to appear in their community, those are signs, those are indicators that something is happening or it's going to happen in their community.
Judge Leslie Harris of Boston's Suffolk County Juvenile Court knows the positive effect of intervention firsthand.
When people become active, when they become involved, people on all levels, the police, the courts, the community, when they all become active, it makes a difference. When children see that someone cares, they act different. And then whether that's in the schools or on the streets, when they know that police officers first off say, I will be there to protect you under these circumstances, you cannot do these types of things, then they understand that. When you set the limits, kids understand that.
Prosecuting attorney Sarah Buell has handled hundreds of cases on both sides of the juvenile court system.
We've always had a number of wonderful, innovative, creative police officers who really cared about the children in their communities and took that extra time to work with them. And what they found is that these were the children who didn't recidivate. These were the children who didn't end up taking a bed in the prison as an adult. So that we can share those stories with other officers and help them understand it's in your best interest to invest the time now so that you're not responding to this child over and over again and then as an adult.
Sergeant Wes McBride specializes in anti-gang operations for the Los Angeles County Sheriff's Department. According to McBride, documentation plays a key role in fighting gang activity, as well as identifying kids at risk.
Now, this wall is a sample of some of the gang style of graffiti that you'll see in California. In this case, this is a representation of what would happen back east with the Latin Kings disrespecting the folk gangsters by putting their pitchfork upside down. You need to know every name on this board. Every name. You need to know who stands behind that and why. It's important that you catalog the evidence from the walls. Because these walls are going to get painted over. You need evidence of the crime and of this person, which would then become part of our gang file, showing that we know this person and we know that he did this. You could say that Bozo or Little Chavo painted this on this day, and you would label that. That become part of your gang file. Because maybe, just maybe, that's a young clique, a new clique of that gang. Maybe you got a chance to go in and stop these guys. Maybe you can go to their parents, say, hey, do you know that this is on this wall and that you're responsible for that because they're under 17? That's going to cost you about $3,000 to clean that wall. That's coming out of your pocket.
Me, I need a Spanish speaker.
Another officer who really gets people thinking about intervention is Natalie Macias. She is director and developer of community-based law enforcement programs for the L.A. County Sheriff's Department.
In planning any type of mobilization or revitalization for the community, you have to create short-term successes. And by that, I mean hosting a neighborhood meeting where you get people to come out and you can watch the light bulb going on as they think, hey, I could do that. I could make sure that at least my house and the house next door are cleaned up, or I could watch out for my neighbor, or something so simple as writing down that license plate number and turning that in to the cops when I see them. There's a lot of little things that can happen.
For Lieutenant Paul Porter of the Randolph, Massachusetts Police Department, an important intervention tool is the Field Information and Observation Note, or FIO.
I conveyed him a neutral to it. As part of that FIO, we take a photograph of the child. Often, we will also give the child a photograph of himself. We would later use those in the forms of lineups if a crime was committed in that neighborhood. Now we have a list of possible suspects that could possibly be involved in that crime, or people that were in the area or we known to frequent that area. We also use the photographs in a positive aspect, the kids to do some positive community work like fixing something that had been vandalized. We'll take a picture of the before and after.
People judge us by the way we dress, how we look, who we hang around with, and they just give us a bad image, and deep down inside, most of us are good kids. You know, we're just trying to make the best of life, but people give us a real hard time. They just judge without actually knowing us. We need jobs. We need people to take the time to say, this is right, this is wrong. You need this. You need to do this. And people aren't doing that. They're just automatically judging us without giving us an opportunity.
If you're into that isolationist mode that, well, that's the other side of town, it's going to be your side of town pretty soon. Well, that's not really my school, my kid. It's going to be your kid in your school. I think we need to say, yes, they're all our kids. And I'm as concerned about the kids in my family as I'm concerned about the kid down the street, down the block.
We find that incarceration has not worked largely because the only focus has been punitive. And particularly with adolescents and young people, they need to know we have faith in them, that we believe they are capable of changing, that just because they committed crimes or bad acts, that we know they don't have to do that again.
Study after study shows that the longer you can keep a child out of a criminal justice system, probably the better off he's going to be. Because when he is incarcerated with other criminals, he's going to learn criminal activity.
We opened a new jail, state-of-the-art jail, at the same time one of our public schools was discredited. Not because of the students, not because of the teacher, but because of the physical facility. We have aging schools and state-of-the-art prisons. And somewhere along the line, we've got to reverse that.
Police officers are not social workers. That's not to say they cannot be facilitators, they cannot be coordinators, and they cannot be referral agents. But for them to do that, they have to have a different set of tools. No longer can our tools be simply our mace, our handcuffs, and our gun belts. Our tools have to be those partners we have within the community. And it's necessary that we go out and seek them.
It does work. The more contact that children, that people in the community have with our deputies and our officers, the better law enforcement works in those communities.
I think it's working 100%. We have a lot of good things happening all the time. The police are very visible with the kids in the town, with the youth in the town.
Given the opportunity, I think kids will succeed. I think that we have summer programs in Los Angeles that we provide youngsters with summer jobs, and we see many of them turning from the where they were showing the peripheral signs of being involved in gang activity. You'll see a kid later, 6 months later, and you see a total different youngster.
We have a responsibility too. We have to take some initiative, and our initiatives by getting out of those cruises and by talking to people in normal daily experiences, We develop this trust and respect.
I believe we do have a choice. I believe that there's always a choice. We can totally ignore children and let them go about life on their own. Or we can be there and say, this is the path you should take. And I will show you how to get further along on that path.
Maybe that one thing that you did, the one talk that you gave that kid, the one break you gave him, the ride home, and maybe the counseling that you gave to him, 30, 40 seconds in the car, that changed his life.
Creating a safer community begins with intervention. Whatever your role in law enforcement, you can choose to reinforce positive behavior and build relationships with young people. You can make the difference.
My mom has always been behind me 100%, and she's told me that she will always be there for me. And everybody needs somebody to say, hey, if you fall, I'm only here to help you get up and start walking again. We need somebody, we need people to encourage us and to let us know, hey, you have a helping hand if you need it.
I take the time with each individual child because they're my children. I mean, it's a very personal kind of work.
There were times when I didn't have faith in myself, when others had faith in me, who believed that I could be somebody and be something in life, and took the time to invest in me. It would be shortchanging them if I didn't do the same thing.
Regardless of bureaucracy and all the other problems that we all go through and frustrate us with, remember why we took this job.
And even though they're not your immediate, you know, blood family, they're still our kids. They're still our kids in the city. And I think that's what keeps most police officers going, knowing that they are making a difference out there. And I think officers that buy into their communities, officers that buy into the community policing, officers that buy into the prevention and intervention, they will really see that they are making a difference. And it's not just 8 hours of chasing the radio calls in a police car. They are making a difference out there, and I think that's what keeps us going.